Vanessa, Umang, thank you again for joining the panel today. Really excited to have the conversation around intersectionality in the LGBTQ community. Just kind of before I jump into the first question, you know, something intersectionality is a conversation we've been having a lot in the last 2-3 years. And when I think a little bit about D&I strategy and how intersectionality fit, I kind of go back a little bit to about 10 years ago when in tech, you know, the big movement started around D&I was women in tech. And then slowly we start to see the conversation around LGBTQ community. Black Lives Matter have really proposed the conversation around Black communities, Indigenous communities. And what was interesting is we've always took these communities in silos to have that conversation. And so today, as we really start exploring intersectionality, my first question is, what does intersectionality mean to you? And we'll start with Vanessa.
Yeah, it's a great question, and I'm so glad that we're starting with it. Intersectionality to me means a lot of things, but since I'm also here sort of on behalf of my employer, the Government of Canada, I thought it might be nice to root my definition of intersectionality and what the Government of Canada currently offers its employees as a definition. As many people know, the Government of Canada remains a feminist government right now under Prime Minister Trudeau. And we have the option to take GBA plus training, which is gender-based analysis plus training. And the plus brings the intersectional lens to it. So employees are supposed to think about gender, sex, language, ethnicity and race, religion, age, disability, geography, culture, income, sexual orientation, and education in any of the projects that we do it. And I actually think that big cluster of labels and concepts is a really helpful way for us to approach our work. So for me in my workplace, that's the definition of intersectionality that I bring. Outside of work, it's just how I am. It's who I am. It's how I operate. So I'd love to hear what you both think of intersectionality, of course.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thank you. Oh man, go ahead and I'll go after you.
Sure. So for me, intersectionality means we don't see ourselves as just one thing. We see multiple parts of our identity. It could be how we were born, where we were born, how we were raised, our lived experience right now. So for example, I see myself as Indian born, gay in terms of my sexual orientation, an immigrant to the United States, now a middle-aged man. Parts of our identities evolve and change over time. And I think the sum is greater than the parts, right? So I think that's what makes each of us rich. We're not looking at things through just one lens. I'd say the other part of intersectionality is how different communities or communities who identify primarily one way intersect in society at large, at a workplace, etc. So there's that aspect of intersectionality as well, where we realize each of us has some unique challenges, each community has some unique challenges, but there are also some challenges we all face jointly, some opportunities and challenges that each of us has jointly as well.
Absolutely. And I love you talked about identity, because when I think about intersectionality, I always go, you know, in order to explain what intersectionality means, you really want to look at identity. One of the things that's been fascinating, and I have a quick story here to kind of sum identities and kind of showcase the complexity of intersectionality. QueerTech is doing a research, right? And one of the elements to understand LGBTQ experiences in the tech industry. And so in a survey we wanted to conduct, we had a question about how do you identify? Now, the team have spent so many hours, we couldn't agree on the drop down, how we can kind of categorize people. So we decided we're gonna leave it open. And then once we have the answers, we'll collect them together. And we had about 220 valid answers on this survey. And so we go back to the identity question, and guess how many answers we got out of the 220 answers? 220 different identity answers. And that just so how complex, like not even one single person have identified the same as another person in that list. And so that really showed that complexity of identity and how do we see identity, right? People tend to want to put you in a box when you fill a form, and we get used to it all the time because, you know, government needs to categorize people, organization needs to categorize, but we get used to it. And so we believe that people fit on these boxes, but it really makes that intersectionality complex. And so when I think about intersectionality, for me, it's a combination of privilege and disadvantage that we carry and the experiences we live. And that's something that everyone carry, but we also forget when sometimes we talk about privilege and people, you know, feel offended that we call them, you have privilege, but I'm like, you have your privilege and your disadvantage and you can't think of them as a silo. And so that's kind of a little bit how I look at that intersectionality, is really making sure that people understand, you know, we all carry privilege, we all carry disadvantage, and we all have our unique experiences that impact that. The fact that I'm a person of color and queer, and Umang is a person of color, queer, doesn't mean we both have the same experience, right? And so, and really this is kind of a great set to think, because a lot of times when we are setting up even D&I strategy, right, within companies, or we talk about within the community, like how do you think intersectionality is broadening the lens of inclusion and why it's important to talk about it today? Umang, we'll start with you this time.
Sure. So I think that instead of each of us fighting our own fights, because there are fights to be fought, right? There are rights still to be won.
Yeah.
I think it's really helped us build strength in numbers.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to take it also into the territory of allyship. Mm-hmm. Certainly for the LGBTQ community, I think we would have struggled to get where we've gotten as fast as we've gotten.
Absolutely.
Without the help of a lot of allies, right? And so I think the different communities and different identities we represent should and can and do also ally with each other. And we be able to fight the common fight as a result of that. There's another layer of this as well, even within the LGBTQ community, because it is an alphabet soup after all. And, you know, we all have slightly different identities and slightly different needs and concerns, right? And so it's also important for us to be allies with each other, even within the LGBTQ community. And then, of course, at a higher level, the LGBTQ community needs to also be allies with women, for example, with people of color, with veterans, for example. And again, there are intersections that each of us has within all of those groups and the many, many others that exist. And so I really, again, coming back to my main point, which was there's strength in numbers. We're no longer just 10% of the population or 5% of the population. Yeah. Together, we are a very large group, and almost everyone, really, I believe, can find a way to identify with one group or intersection or the other when you have that lens.
That's awesome. Thank you, Umang. Vanessa, what are your thoughts?
So, this is another really great and important question. I think for me, what I've seen intersectionality do for our communities is give us language to talk about these differences in inclusion and exclusion that people are experiencing, the differences in power and privilege that people have. It's given us a shared language to have sometimes difficult conversations, which we didn't have before it really came into sort of our common language. And I'm a huge fan of having shared concepts for us to use to discuss and push conversation, especially when it comes to like designing better forms that are more inclusive. Like intersectionality is such an important concept for even just designing better forms. And without that language, we would be definitely at a loss.
Absolutely. Because, you know, it's interesting. We get so used to have the conversation around the community. Like we talk about the LGBTQ community again, right? Or women. And one of the things even when we're like, you know, women in tech and a lot of companies or tech companies will have that movement around women. I'm like, you know, it's interesting because what white women needs and black women and a lesbian black woman and a black trans woman is completely different needs. And if you look at it from a lens of inclusion, but from this big lens that it's just one category, then you really miss your strategy around diversity and inclusion and making people feel included because you are not understanding the need and challenges. So, and I love how you put it. It's really well put. And so, you know, one of the message we're hoping to accomplish even today is also talking about, you know, what is that one thing you wish leadership or management teams, you know, understand about the reality of working in this existing system and structure, right? Of multi-generational people, where we talk a lot about D&I, we're still struggling to implement effective strategies. Companies are still thinking, but you know, because we are not talking about the system and the structures that govern everything that we discuss. So if you think about intersectionality, you think about the structure and the system we're existing, what are some of the advice that or message you wish leadership team and the management team think about when they're building their strategy? Vanessa, why don't you go this time?
I'm going to actually build on something you've already brought up, which is these women in tech movements. One thing for leadership and management teams right now is stop running those events. It's not that women in tech don't need support, but I think that women ends up being a very exclusive category that does not serve, especially trans folks of color who are really facing challenges in our industry. I'm non-binary folks as well are not being served by these women in tech events or conversations or programs. I just would love to see those programs go and would love to see management instead focus on addressing the toxic behaviors that are being demonstrated not only by themselves, but by other people in the industry. Focus on those things. Yeah. Get rid of your women in tech events. It's so 2 decades ago.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Thanks, Vanessa. Umang, what are your thoughts?
I would say a couple of things, right? I'd still say that management can sometimes be quite insulated from the general population. They know each other, they hang out with each other, they socialize with each other. And so I think that they should ask themselves, does my company represent society? Number one, right? Number two, does my leadership team, does my middle management represent the rest of my company? Does my leadership team represent the rest of my company, right? And I think they've got to make the effort to see those identities reflected in the leadership team, at the boardroom level, etc. Each of us comes with our own challenges. Each of us comes with our own sensitivities and our own stories. And I think the moment they even begin to have one or two or three of their leaders come from different parts of the community, each of us can then act as a bridge to other allies, right? Again, we're working on this together. And I've seen the difference that makes, even when one leader comes in who is, has a slightly different identity, they are able to be that bridge to the needs of, you know, the many, many different parts of the community. Now, again, you shouldn't overburden just one person. Yeah. You see that sometimes at companies where it's that poor one person who's suddenly being approached by, the LGBTQ employee group, the Black employee resource group, etc. And that's really, it's great when people take on that challenge and work through it. But I think you at least need that. And then the leadership team, you know, there's always going to be a transition, right?
Yeah.
From a team that's all homogenous to one that starts including other people. And that transition time is also really challenging because the people who come in feel like they're imposters sometimes. They feel they're all alone. They feel isolated. And I think it takes a lot for the leadership team to really work on welcoming these new identities in until, you know, everyone's in a comfortable number where they don't feel that any longer. So I think there's a lot for management and leadership to do, from hiring to the right representation at all levels and making sure people feel comfortable when they are in these, at these different levels within a company.
Absolutely. You know, we talk a lot about, you know, system and structure is something that we've inherited for a long time, have been built over time. And unfortunately, we still live in that system of power and oppression, right? And that's just how society have been developed. And now we have to break through that. And what you said, Umang, is perfect on how I think about how do you address the issue. Because I'm like, if you are someone on a corporate level, on a leadership team, on a management team, and you're sitting in a boardroom and you look around you and everyone looks the same as you, you are part of that power and you are oppressing other people. And you can make that decision to make that change. And that's where it starts. And you are either part of that system or you want to change the system. And changing the system is hard. We know that, but it's going to take people taking guts and making that change happen to move forward. And kind of just to wrap up our conversation, I always think, what is that one takeaway that you want people to go with today from the conversation today? Umang, we'll start with you this time.
Sure. So, I mean, I began the conversation by saying that we all have many different aspects to us. And I always try when I'm working with someone new, interacting with someone new, to find that common ground with them, because I genuinely believe that in 80 to 90% of the cases, there is something you can find that connects you to somebody else. So I'd say my biggest takeaway is to basically to find that common ground, to recognize that we're all a part of this large rainbow coalition, and to recognize when something's, you know, a community is being wronged or an identity is being wronged, to speak out for it. I've done that a few times, and I've had that done for me by allies of mine within companies, within different organizations I've been a part of. And I'd say, we should all just work together and continue paying it forward.
Absolutely. Thanks, Umang. Vanessa?
My one takeaway is actually kind of similar to Umang's. It's that for folks, especially white folks like myself, I think it's really important for us to come into conversations and sort of really shut up and listen is the phrase that I use crassly with some of my friends, really engage in the conversations, get to know people for who they are, and then be open to them changing as well. Because as we've all discussed, you know, identity isn't a static thing. Gender especially is not a static thing. And so really come to your conversations and your engagements with your employees, with your peers, with an open mind and an open ear, and go from there, and you'll be able to build better programs and systems.
Absolutely. Like, I love that. You know, human beings are complex beings, and we can't really think of us as just one box in a form or one category of ourselves. We all have that intersectionality. We come again with our privilege, we come with our disadvantage, and experience the fact that we are from the same community doesn't mean that we live the same experiences. And I think that's really important when people are going into a conversation with someone, to not let that stereotype come to your mind and just generalize because you think that you know someone from the community who have certain experience. This has been a wonderful conversation. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you.
I know. Thank you both. Vanessa, that was really nice, working with you as well.
Yeah, nice meeting you both briefly. I wish we had longer, actually. Like,
I know.
I'd love to know even like how wonderful. You got into tech and like, yeah, there's so many things.
All right. Like, yeah, great conversation.